I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out, wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Our broadcast is from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. I've been on a fitness challenge, a fitness quest for about 2 or 3 years now. You've heard me talk about the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge. We've produced that in partnership with the FitLab in St. Paul, a program that tries to create awareness about the need for increased physical activity, for doing things that change and support a longer and more high quality life for people like me. And I've had marvelous results, both by physical activity, but also our program contains a component that provides nutrition advice and counseling. It contains a program that also provides mental health support. I'm pleased to have the nutrition advisor, my health coach, my nutrition coach, Julie McMahon, here today. Julie, thank you for being here.
Yes, thank you, Al. Thanks for having me on.
Your company is Nutrition Julie.
And
you're in the business of selecting or directing and advising individuals like Al McFarlane on strategies to have a body that works and that works more efficiently. Talk about the value proposition of the Nutrition Julie business.
Yes, well, I'm a holistic health coach and I'm a certified nutrition educator. And so my passion is guiding people through dietary and lifestyle upgrades that will really just amplify their lives. Mm-hmm. So I believe that we have a choice. We really have a choice in how we live, how we age, how we look, how we feel, how much energy we have in a day. And I believe it all starts with food. And so I've created a system called the Food First System. And what it entails is looking at food first, making food a priority. So many of us kind of wander through the day saying, oh, maybe what can I grab for lunch here? What can I grab for dinner? So really making food a priority and also using food first before we reach for pharmaceuticals. So that's what I drive to do.
And food first to me means you advise and direct and help people be planful.
Yes.
Be conscious and to examine what they're going to do, do what they intend to do, and not what they grab just because it's the time of day or they're hungry. Be planning how to navigate your day with energy.
Right.
And food is energy, right?
Absolutely, food is energy. And, you know, I get it. I'm a mom of five kids. I get the convenience factor, but really it is all about making conscious decisions that will impact your life in a really positive way, not just your health, not just your weight, but also how you're thinking and feeling through the day.
I've had a chance to work with you for about a year now, maybe 2 years. How long has it been?
I know, I was trying to put a time to that.
It's been a while.
A little over a year.
Yeah. But it's been a wonderful experience. You've been a coach for me and my wife, Bobby.
Yes.
And you've visited with us almost once a week for this period of time. Plus, we work together on the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge, and you're providing the same kind of counseling to the other participants in the Health Challenge. One of the things I've discovered, the new language I'm getting, the new vocabulary that comes from my association with you, is the language about gut flora.
Yes.
Didn't know what that was, you know,
yeah.
So talk about that.
A lot of people are unaware of this whole other life that's going on in our gut. And really, if we were in Eastern medicine or in the East, no matter what we went to the doctor for, we would be looking at gut health first. Mm-hmm. So if you went in and you were depressed or anxious or overweight or had digestive issues, mm-hmm. no matter what it would be, they would start with the gut, because your gut kind of dictates how the rest of your health is going to be.
What does that mean? What is in the gut that does that?
So we have good bacteria in our gut. We have bad bacteria. We have yeast. We have all sorts of things that live in our gut. And most people, not most, I shouldn't say that, but a lot of people are walking around with an abundance of bad bacteria and not enough good.
Even that's kind of illuminating for ordinary people, because you're taught to think that all bacteria is bad.
Right.
And you think that the omnipresent solution should be antibacterial, this, that, or the other.
Yeah.
And so that's probably, there's some truth in that, but it's not the truth, right?
Right.
And so people don't know that they have to discern and differentiate between, you know, what bacteria in the environment are productive and positive, and those that deteriorate life.
Right. And a lot of our good bacteria are killed off by really common things: processed foods, sugar, alcohol, mm-hmm. stress, environmental toxins. Mm-hmm. I mean, hello, we live on planet Earth, right? I mean, all these things are killing off our good gut flora.
And when you get sick and they give you an antibiotic for that particular malady, it has the unintended consequence, or maybe it's intended, of destroying all the bacteria, good and bad, in your system.
It really does.
And people don't know they have to be intentional in restoring that which was good, that was destroyed as part of the process of healing.
Yes, anytime you've been on an antibiotic, you really need to amp up again and add the good bacteria back in. And a lot of people do that with probiotics. Mm-hmm. Another great strategy is fermented foods. And in our culture here in America, we really did a poor job of bringing over the fermented foods from whatever cultures we came from. Mm-hmm. Most other places in the world have raw fermented foods that are full of these good bacteria that we need. Mm-hmm. But I see this a lot with kids especially, you know, the kids that continually get ear infections. Mm-hmm. They get that first one and then they get an antibiotic and their body doesn't have that good bacteria anymore to keep fighting off more ear infections. Mm-hmm. So it's so important to just build it up again.
How does the good bacteria originate inside the body? A couple of ways, I understand. One, you're born with it, right?
Yeah.
And how else? Let's describe good bacteria. Describe the notion, the idea, and the work of good bacteria in the body.
Yes, well, you brought up a couple things there. So we get our good bacteria from our mother. Mm-hmm. So we rely on the health of our mother, really, at the time we were born. So if your mother was very sick or in ill health, you would not get as much good bacteria as you would have otherwise. Also, you need to have a regular birth, not a cesarean birth. If you're born cesarean, you miss out on that inoculation of good bacteria. And also when we nurse our babies, mm-hmm. we're passing on those good bacteria. Mm-hmm. So there's hundreds of different good bacteria, bad bacteria in our body. There's all different ones. And so they all have sort of different functions, mm-hmm. but mainly what they do, they help a lot with mood. If I have somebody come to me with anxiety or depression, my first grab for them is, let's look at your gut health. Let's amp that up. If I have somebody that comes to me that's sick a lot, mm-hmm. or has immune issues, same thing. I'm looking at amping up their gut health. Mm-hmm. Or digestive issues. A lot of people have digestive issues. And it's really just that they're suffering from what's called gut dysbiosis. Too much bad and not enough good, mm-hmm. you know?
And so there are things that we do that destroy the bacteria, the good bacteria. You mentioned alcohol. You mentioned a couple other things.
Yes, sugar. Processed foods.
Okay. And so I've come to where, Julie, from talking to you, I've developed the sense that sugar is my enemy. Yeah, maybe I've walked off the deep end on this.
Well, I'm right there with you.
Okay. And so, but I've gotten to where I try to avoid at all cost, you know, sugar, or as much as I can. There's always some. But I'm not looking for sugar anymore. And, for example, soda pop, can't do it.
Yeah.
You know? And a lot of the bars or candy or whatever that I used to do, simply can't do it, don't want to do it.
Yeah.
But sugar, so I've gotten to where my mind tells me sugar is not your friend, and you need to avoid it.
Yes, sugar causes a lot of inflammation in our body, and pretty much all disease comes from inflammation in your body. You really want to avoid that. Sugar also kills off the good bacteria that we were just talking about. And a lot of people crave sugar. A lot of people crave salt. And really, it's because they are not getting the proper nutrients in their body. Mm-hmm. Once you're off sugar, you don't crave it as much. Mm-hmm. It's kind of an addictive thing, you know. Mm-hmm. But once you get away from it, you realize it wasn't your friend. Mm-hmm. So, yes, I'm glad you had that happen in your life.
And how about salt? Here's my take on salt.
Yes.
I understood that for African Americans or black people, salt and hypertension kind of go hand in hand. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's really true, but that's what we think and what we say. So there was a reason, a motivation to do less salt. You introduced me to pink Himalayan sea salt.
Yes.
And I'm able to use that, but I don't have the same craving for saltiness and salt food that I used to have.
Yes.
And so the only salt I use now, ever, is the Himalayan sea salt, and I use that very sparingly as well. I think particularly once a day when I start off each morning with a glass of water, lemon, and sea salt. That's really it.
Absolutely. And yes, you're absolutely right.
I feel I'm not missing anything.
You're not.
Yeah.
The regular white processed table salt that most of us grew up with, that most of us see in restaurants or maybe in our own cupboards, that certainly is toxic, and that does cause more hypertension and issues. And that is to be avoided completely. But we do need salt. We need salt so that our cells really absorb water properly and we get enough hydration and enough minerals. So the pink Himalayan salt definitely has the minerals that we need. It has 84 trace minerals. And that will help drive that water into your cells. So we do need salt. We just don't need the bad salt. We need good salt.
I remember as a kid, Albert, Julie, the move to make iodized salt.
Yes.
How do you switch away from commercial salt and still get the iodine that your body needs?
Right. Well, and that you bring up a very good point, because our bodies do need iodine, especially with some of the things like Fukushima happening in the world, mm-hmm. where there's more radiation, and we need the iodine to protect ourselves, mm-hmm. to protect our thyroid in particular. So the iodized salt really has a very low level of iodine. It wasn't really giving us what we needed anyway. A much better source is seaweeds. And I know that can be a tough pill to swallow for some people, you know. But seaweed is an excellent strategy for getting in your iodine. Also, there is iodine supplementation that if somebody had a thyroid issue, they might choose to go that route. There's also seaweed tablets that you can just swallow if you don't want to go chewing on a piece of seaweed.
You mentioned probiotics.
Yes.
So one of the new things in my life is a regular probiotic, along with a couple of items. One is called spirulina.
Yes.
And another is called, what's the other one?
Chlorella.
Chlorella,
yes.
Right? So tell me what I'm doing and why am I doing this?
Spirulina and chlorella are wonderful. They are both extremely high in protein, mm-hmm. and they are green foods that are needed in our body. We need more green foods. So high in protein, high in antioxidants, high in B vitamins, minerals, enzymes, amino acids. It goes on and on. They are a couple of my favorite top superfoods. Mm-hmm. And I use them in smoothies. I use them in salads, wherever I can kind of tuck them in, especially for my kids, just tuck them in and they don't know that they're so healthy.
Mm-hmm. Probiotics.
Yes.
What about them?
What about them?
I mean, what do they do? What does the probiotic regimen do for the body?
Yeah.
In the gut health area.
Yes, well, the probiotic is pro-life, is what that actually means.
Okay.
Antibiotics are anti-life.
Okay.
So a probiotic, again, is that good bacteria that we talked about.
Mm-hmm.
And so it just replenishes mm-hmm. your system with those good bacteria.
Mm-hmm. So when Bobby and I go to the health food store to, you know, and buy probiotics or one-a-day supplements, right? We look for something that says, oh, it's 15 billion units or
yes.
30 billion or 50 billion, so we get hyped at the more billions. So what's going on with that? What does that mean? What are we really measuring, and what are we getting when we try to find the right probiotic?
Yes, well, my recommendation is usually at least 20 billion or more, mm-hmm. and that's 20 billion of those little probiotic bacteria that mm-hmm. that we want. Mm-hmm. I also look for
so that
one.
Means a dose, which is a capful or a spoon, mm-hmm. would be contain 20 billion of the bacteria in that mix, right?
Yes, and so, I should say that they vary greatly in just all the different probiotics on the shelf. Mm-hmm. They vary greatly in how many of those are actually still living at the time they've mm-hmm. made it through transport mm-hmm. on the shelf and to your mm-hmm. counter and into your system.
So the items I buy are alive.
They are alive, so and we want to treat them kindly. A mm-hmm. lot of the probiotics you find are in the fridge mm-hmm. or in the refrigerated mm-hmm. area at stores, mm-hmm. and that's just to help them stay alive. Mm-hmm. So sometimes people take a probiotic and then down a glass of coffee or a cup of coffee right after it. Well, really, that heat is just not mm-hmm. conducive to keeping those mm-hmm. Bacteria well and happy mm-hmm. and alive. So always 20 billion or more, and then I do also recommend multiple strains. Mm-hmm. So you can see on the bottle how many strains there are. I say at least 5 or 6 strains. Mm-hmm. We have many, many strains in our body.
So what does that mean? I mean, I'm kind of following you, but I'm presuming that most people watching are not.
Yes.
And so let's break it down. What are you talking about?
When I talk about different strains, there's just really different bacteria, mm-hmm. all of which are good.
It's culture,
it's like
right?
a culture.
Yeah.
If we were in science class doing yeah. our little petri dish yeah. thing, I don't yeah. know, you would find different bacteria in mm-hmm. there. And they serve different functions within our body, mm-hmm. but they all work together okay. Synergistically. Mm-hmm. So since there are so many strains, it's good to populate with a variety of strains mm-hmm. and then continually change up your probiotic mm-hmm. So that you kind of hit all the areas.
So are the probiotics naturally occurring or are they manufactured? What are we doing?
That's a very good question. Mm-hmm. Some are naturally occurring and some are made in a laboratory. Mm-hmm. So my favorite way to get these good bacteria in are really through raw fermented foods, okay. through raw sauerkraut, through raw kimchi, things of that nature, which can be kind of a shock to the tongue at first until you kind of get used
how about
to it.
Yogurt
as yeah. well. Yogurt has a very low bacterial profile usually, mm-hmm. Not as high as maybe the sauerkraut or kimchi. Mm-hmm. But yes, yogurt. I also use coconut water kefir, mm-hmm. so the kefir products also have that in them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you know, this is just fascinating. And, you know, the point is that once you start exploring this, you find a new world.
Yes.
And it's a world into your own body, your own health, and your own moods, and also your own, sort of developing a quality of life. You use the word lifestyle change. That's what this is all about at the end of the day. How do we change our life so that we're in control and that we're responsible for what we ingest and how we expend the energy that life affords us. Is that correct?
Absolutely. And it can be so hard to change our habits. Mm-hmm. We are creatures of habit. We have our things we do every day. And so that's where a health coach can come in handy just mm-hmm. to say, okay, maybe we could do it this way today and really start looking at making some step-by-step changes mm-hmm. that will be lasting in the long run.
So my colleagues and friends who are participants with me and you in the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge
yes.
have had the excitement, the enjoyment of getting some cooking coaching from you as well.
Yeah.
You've brought our classes to cooking demonstrations at local co-op stores. Talk about that for a minute.
Yeah, well, that's a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. So as a group, we go over to the Mississippi Market, we utilize their cooking space, and we really just get in the kitchen and start talking about what is going to be healthy for us, what would make a great breakfast, what would make a great lunch. Mm-hmm. And so I'm always focusing on how to get more vegetables and fruits, especially some raw vegetables and fruits, into our daily intake. That's usually where people aren't getting enough of leafy greens or other greens like collards, Swiss chard, kale, parsley. Mm-hmm. They're not getting enough raw vegetables, raw fruits in their diets. So we mix up a lot of salads, we make some green smoothies, and we also cook up a few things too.
I've enjoyed, you know, I'm a gardener, and yes. You are a gardener as well. And I've just had more fun gardening of late because I have more knowledge, you know, yes. about the benefit of the things that I grow. And I've always grown greens, but this year I think I started growing kale. And I've gotten a huge and bountiful crop of kale, and I'm able to go out in my yard, clip it, bring it in, wash it, chop it, and make a smoothie for breakfast, lunch, or dinner. And that's so rewarding, and it's so fulfilling, and you've given me some suggestions and recipes. But the main thing is that I enjoy this idea of eating green. That's a new thing for me,
yes.
and to avoid processed bread, for example, processed foods as much as possible, and to go more with raw, and in a smoothie or just raw, you know,
right.
The salads, the tomatoes, and for a period of time, I'd almost gone to close to vegetarian. I never claimed and never want to decide to be a vegetarian,
right.
but I've greatly eliminated my animal protein intake, and if I choose to, I do. But as a requirement, there's no requirement for me anymore for animal protein. I'm finding that protein in vegetables and in supplements. What do you think about that?
Oh, there's a ton of protein in vegetables, mm-hmm. And absolutely doable. And as you mentioned before, spirulina, chlorella, things like that, where we can add in plant sources mm-hmm. of protein. And I love that you love to garden, and it's such a great way to be connected mm-hmm. to nature and connected to your food source. And yes, it is so fun to just walk out in your garden, see what's growing, bring it in, make a salad, make a smoothie. It's such a different dynamic than going to the grocery store, and sometimes these foods have traveled hundreds of miles to get to us, and in that time they've lost a lot of their nutrition. So
I'm Al McFarlane. You're listening to, you're watching Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest is Julie McMahon. Julie is my nutrition coach. She's a partner with the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge. We'll come back and talk more about that in a few minutes. Please come back.
I just want to be with you in the morning. I'll share a cup of coffee and make a good one. Give you a little bit of weather, a little bit of that thing we say.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane, our broadcast from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. My guest is my friend Julie McMahon. She's a nutrition coach, a health coach, certified nutritionist, and she's working with me and my wife Bobby on our personal quest to improve our health. Our goal, our mission, Julie, is longevity with quality. I'm 68, Bobby just turned 67. We both feel like we're, say, 30s, 40s. We know
nice.
How old we are, but I think I can speak for her. Our energy and our vibration, our attitude about where we are, we think we have great energy, sufficient energy, an attitude that gives us the spirit of doing, you know, and of making things happen. I think that's a fairly energetic, robust, youthful orientation. So what we're doing with you helps us maintain and improve that. Our goal, I tell people, is that I see me and Bobby being together, walking down the street, holding hands, well past 100.
Yes.
You know, and I'm saying it's doable. It can be done.
Absolutely.
God willing, and if we do right, you know, it can happen.
Yes.
And so it's important then to have this conversation about what we must do to do our part in making this journey happen. What do you think about that?
What I really love is that you both are doing this together. Mm-hmm. So often I'll have clients come in and they want to make a change, but maybe their spouse doesn't want to, or maybe they're not well supported in their family. Mm-hmm. It has been just beautiful to watch you and Bobby go through this process together. And absolutely, once you feel better, you start to resonate on a higher frequency, and you start to think about other things maybe that you still want to do in this lifetime. Mm-hmm. And so I've watched you guys go through that process, and it's been beautiful.
Well, it's a fun thing for us to do. What's important, too, is what we're doing together with you at the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge. And so talk about the kind of experiences you've had, first of all, as a coach, providing direction and feedback and support to me and other members of the Fitness Challenge. This, what we're doing, is really a great thing. It's a great idea, putting together a strong fitness program, a strong nutrition counseling program, and a strong mental health support program. It's a unique combination, and the beauty of the thing is that this thing is driven by McFarlane Media Insight News, so we're able to be very public about our experience. And our goal is to create conversation in the community about health and to change the conversation, change the narrative so that our people begin to articulate a vision of healthfulness, of activity, of knowledge around food, around nutrition, and around physical activity. That's what the goal is from my point of view. From your point of view as a nutrition coach, what's the excitement in this program?
Oh, the excitement. Well, first of all, everyone there is so fun to work with. It's a really great community of people that all support each other. You know, it's a challenge. They're all competing against one another, but really, they're all really supporting one another. So for me, it's all about education and also empowerment, really giving people the tools they need to succeed and to make their goals, their health goals. And so it's fun to watch that process.
What kind of feedback have you gotten? I know that at the end of each session, people either send notes or tell you this experience has meant to them, and they really praise you for opening their lives to a body of knowledge and a new set of experiences. But what have you heard back from the participants?
I've had such wonderful feedback. Both people send me cards, people send me emails. They're grateful. They're grateful that I just gave them that extra bit of knowledge they needed to take care of themselves well. So a lot of gratitude, a lot of life-changing transformation. People who really felt like they were going down a road of possible chronic disease and illness and obesity, and really turning that corner and feeling great, feeling energetic, and feeling like, I'm doing this on my own. You know, you're giving me the tools, but I'm empowered and I'm doing this. And so I love that feedback. It's been awesome.
So this last round, you joined the program as well as a participant.
Yeah.
Talk about that.
Well, not one of my better ideas, no. I did. I wanted to get a better idea of what it's like to really go through the fitness portion of the challenge. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's,
it's grueling. It's and I'm a person that works out all the time anyway, but this was another level. And definitely I felt the support and love of the group, which was really motivating and really fun to be a part of. I mean, I went there sometimes thinking, oh, do I really want to go? Do I really want to do this? I think we've all had that feeling on the way to the gym sometimes.
All the time, right?
But
here's the way it works, you know. So like you get in your car, you procrastinate getting in your car first of all. You finally get in your car and you kind of hope the traffic is real bad so that you have a reason to turn around and go back home, and the traffic works out not in your favor but in the favor of what you're supposed to do. So you show up and then you dread the possibility that this work is going to be, you know, horrific, I mean just punishing, and you know it's going to be, and it is. But then when it's about 10 minutes to over, you say, just 10 minutes to go, I can do this. That's the lesson they tell you. They tell you to say, I can do anything for a minute. I can do anything for a minute. And so you get 1 minute, one more. Guess what? It's over. And you feel so good.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I've gone there after a real hard day at work, or maybe I'm sad about this or that or whatever. But when I leave there after that workout, I feel rejuvenated. I feel happy. I feel like I've got my group with me and that everything's going to be okay. So it's a real powerful community group experience.
And so the lesson, I think, for our viewers and our listeners is that we can keep putting off things or we can dive in. And what I want people to do is thinking about diving in, getting busy, getting fit. And what I really want people to do, Julie, is to decide that in our community, we have among us the resources and people like Nutrition Julie, people like Tyrone Minor, mm-hmm. People like Dr. Darren Moore, we have the resources and the capacity to engage ourselves, to challenge ourselves, and to bit by bit, incrementally experience growth, development, the achievement of the fitness and health goals, to do the life changing that will give us the quality of life. And if we do that individually, we end up being a source in our community that begins to change the entire community. The life-changing experience that we're looking for has an end game, and that end game is that the whole community change, that the society is improved. So it's a question of me doing my part that enables and creates an attraction, a light for others to begin to do their part. Does that make sense to you?
Absolutely. The ripple effect. You know, I'm working with maybe one person, then they go home, they tell their husband about it. Mm-hmm. They start to feed their kids differently. Mm-hmm. It's a huge, huge ramification. Once you start working with one person, that just spreads throughout the community. Mm-hmm. And you're right, the conversation starts to change. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So
what's your vision? What do you want to do long-term with Nutrition Julie, with that business? What is your goal?
I would like to create an education center where people can learn how to grow their food. They can learn what they want to be eating or what they need to be eating for optimal health, and also how to prepare the food. So there'd be greenhouses, cooking facilities on site so that I could take somebody through that whole process and take groups through that process. So included in that vision would be bringing in school groups. You know, let's talk to these kids before they get older and sick, right? Let's teach them right away when they're young.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest is Julie McMahon. She's my nutrition coach, a partner in the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge, the challenge organized by McFarlane Media and the FitLab. It's a project that brings a group of people together for 10-week programs that include and that feature rigorous, vigorous, challenging physical fitness, but it's supported by counseling information that is provided by Julie McMahon, Nutrition Julie, and by our friend and partner Tyrone Minor, the owner of the FitLab. Tyrone and his wife, Jamie Minor. Jamie Minor. You know, let's talk about them for a minute. Jamie and Tyrone. She is a certified yoga instructor,
yes.
And he's a certified fitness trainer. He's a school teacher as well, but they work so well together and create this environment that invites all of us into their business, the FitLab, mm-hmm. so that we can learn and share and support each other. I think it's a wonderful thing.
Oh, they complement each other so well. Mm-hmm. You know, when I am in the gym doing the workouts, mm-hmm. One will have me moving and going, you can guess which one. And
right.
The other one will make slight tweaks in how I'm moving and say, you know, make sure that your knee is here, your foot is here, to make sure that I'm not injuring myself. Mm-hmm. I feel very well supported when I'm in their capable hands.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'll come back and talk more with Julie in just a minute. This is Al McFarlane, Conversations with Al McFarlane. Stay tuned. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest is my friend, Julie McMahon. Her company is called Nutrition Julie. She's a partner with me and others in a project we call the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge. In fact, I invite you to follow her work. She's a great writer, a great communicator, and a regular columnist in Insight News. Phenomenal stories, good pieces about health, about food, and about community, about moving life forward in a positive way. You know, you mentioned early, Julie, that your New Year project is called Food First. Let's go more into that because I want people to know what you're doing, and I want to hear more about it myself as well.
Absolutely.
You said that you're going to be writing a book as well.
Yes.
Let's talk about the Food First concept. Let's explore that.
Absolutely. Well, as I started working with more and more clients, I realized that there were many of the same things, upgrades that people could be making with their diet and lifestyle that would help them. So I put together what's called the Food First System. And again, as I mentioned earlier, it's all about prioritizing food in your life, making time for it, providing people with the tools and resources and recipes they need to make that happen. But also, food first before pharmaceuticals. So also a lot of people that come to me are struggling with, they're on a lot of pharmaceuticals. And many people don't want to be on them, they want to get off of them. I'm not a doctor, I can't say, oh, well, you can't be on that. But I can start to give them the tools that their body needs to be back in balance. So my food first system actually is all about balance. It's honoring the fact that our body wants to heal, our body wants to be well. Mm-hmm. We just need to give it the tools and foods that it needs to get there.
Okay. And so you're doing case studies, you have a book to complement your food first system.
Yes, I am doing some case studies.
So when you say food first systems, what is that gonna mean? What's that mean?
So what it'll be a virtual program. Mm-hmm. So an online program with modules that people can buy into. And so each week they'll get a new set of things to try in their life to put them on that healthy journey. Mm-hmm. And there'll also be coaching time with me and email support and all of that. So it's not totally just virtual. So it's just a way to support a larger community.
Mm-hmm.
Because I am getting a lot of clients, I can't be everywhere at once.
Right.
And so I created this virtual program so that I can help more people.
Excellent. Wonderful, wonderful.
Yes.
Yeah, and talk about the book.
Yes, so there'll be a companion book to that that's called the Food First book.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, it'll go more into my story, how I got on this journey myself.
Mm-hmm.
And why I'm so passionate that people have these tools and resources. And again, give them the tools that they need to be well.
Okay. Well, you set this question up. How did you get started? thank you for saying it that way.
Yes.
But how did you get on this path? What's your story, Julie?
Yeah, so I grew up in a very holistic family. My mom was a nurse. My dad was an accountant, but he came home every day and grew all of our own food. My mom cooked dinner all the time. We had bees for honey, we had an apple orchard, and pretty much if we ate it, we either grew it or my dad went out and hunted for it. So we had a lot of great food choices, and this will probably astonish a lot of people, but we only ate out like once a year. It was like a big deal to eat out, you know, and if you compare that to nowadays when, I mean, people eat out quite frequently. So I grew up in this really holistic environment, and that drove my passion for food and health and wellness. And so when I got older, my dad got sick. He got sick with prostate cancer, and I could not understand it. I could not understand how this person who eats so well and who was such a positive person, always looked at the great side of everything and always laughed, had a great sense of humor. I just couldn't understand, well, how can this person get sick? This just doesn't make sense to me. And so it set me on my journey of really taking more classes, really learning about how the body works, how the body functions, and how our bodies can get out of balance for a variety of reasons, not just eating, but other things as well. And drove my passion to make sure that other people, other families, don't have to experience that. I look back now, and with what I know now, I could have turned the corner for him, I believe I could have helped him.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I'm Al McFarlane, this is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest is Julie McMahon. She's a nutrition coach, a partner in the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge, an author, creating a system called the Food First System, creating a new book. We'll come back in a minute, we'll have Tyrone Minor join the conversation. Stay tuned.
won't you help me sing? This song's the freedom. It's all I ever had. Redemption song. This song's the freedom.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Julie McMahon and I have been talking about the work we do together with the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge, and we're fortunate to be joined now by the maestro, Tyrone Minor. Tyrone, I have to tell you, is a guy that is changing my life. Under his direction and leadership, I've taken on a fitness routine that I never imagined I could do. And as a consequence, I've experienced a loss of over 50, 60 pounds. I've experienced a decrease in blood pressure. I've experienced the ability to run like I never could before. I'm almost 70 years old, but as I said earlier, Julie, I feel like 30, 40. And I attribute that to the work that I put in, that Tyrone is directing me. And a consequence of the work is that Tyrone and I created this partnership that is produced now. It's a seventh Insight to Health Fitness Challenge. Tyrone, thank you for being here.
Yes, thanks for having me.
You know, so you've got a philosophy that you believe people should have a productive, effective life, and you train towards lifestyle change. Talk about that if you would.
Yeah, I mean, for me, fitness is about allowing a person to do everything they want to do every day. Mm-hmm. And so I take that approach to fitness. The focus is on functional movements so that people can be independent. It's a total commitment when it comes to fitness and health. Nutrition, exercise, the mental aspect, even the spiritual aspect. So it's a wholeness approach that I like to guide my clients in.
Tyrone, what's your background? You are elite class athlete. Tell people about your story.
Certainly was in my day. I grew up in the Twin Cities, attended St. Paul Central High School. We were the last St. Paul City and state champions in track and field. Went on to earn a full scholarship at Drake University. Finished my career at the U of M. And then I competed nationally for about a decade after graduation. So that's basically my athletic experience.
Mm-hmm. And then your academic experience, so you've got a master's degree, a couple of master's degrees, and you're a teacher.
Absolutely. I've been a teacher this is my 16th year. Mm-hmm. So I have, like you said, two master's degrees, one in applied kinesiology and the other in sport management. So I'm fortunate to be able to use both of those degrees in my everyday work in teaching and then running the FitLab.
I tell the story about your being my trainer and getting me started on this path, but let me have you tell the story about how we both together have created this opportunity that we're calling the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge.
Yeah, you know, I mean, it started, as you and I know, it was a personal journey for you, you know, in terms of improving your health, and, you know, we've done everything. I mean, we started out in your garage. We were working out all over the Twin Cities, and I think you really embraced everything about a holistic fitness and wellness lifestyle. And then, you know, being the visionary that you are, you wanted to take the energy that you were receiving to the larger community in the Twin Cities area. And so, yeah, I mean, we basically put our brains together and figured out a way of how to bring the model that we had for you in transforming your life to the larger community, in particular, the underserved communities. It's been a pleasure, but you know, I think we're just scratching the surface. Mm-hmm. As far as what we can do, the impact we can have locally nationally and one day internationally.
I love the fact that your company, the FitLab, is a company that involves you and your wife, Jamie Minor. We were talking about you earlier, and that you both bring yoga training and the fitness training, and it's a great combination. And sometimes you work together, sometimes separately. Neither one of you is light. both of you are rough. It's hard. You know, people think that yoga is easy and light. It's not. It's just challenging. So I know the hallmark of my experience, I measure the workout with you, Tyrone, by how fast and how furious the sweat comes. I expect to leave water on the floor every time I'm in your presence, right? And so you think that yoga is going to be relaxing, and it is, but you put as much energy and you burn it the same way. And I love that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
For me, sweat is my applause.
Okay. Well, you know, I'm applauding you all the time. Tyrone, I tell people that, I told you this before too, Julie and I mentioned this, because it's easy for us to have this mental thing where we try to find every reason in the world not to go, not to make it to the class tonight or to the training, right? And look for traffic, we look for anything. But my experience is that once I finally get there, I feel good. Well, here's the other part of that. I used to ache, Julie, I used to ache and pain. And like if training was gonna be Tuesday, you know, at 5 o'clock, and it was Tyrone, and I'd be in knots. And you know, have every reason in the world, you know, to not be able to go up the stairs or down the stairs.
Right.
And even as far as getting over to the FitLab, but once I got in there, that disappeared. And the day happened, and the main thing is that when it's over, I really felt good, you know. So that's a good thing, man.
Yeah, you know, Mac, for a lot of people, they're, when they decide to make a complete change in their lifestyle, I look at it almost like a pathway with doors on the side. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's going to be some rough goings. And I feel like most people are looking for that exit left or right, mm-hmm. you know, doorways. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's my exit out. Mm-hmm. I think that's the fabulous thing with the FitLab and the Insight Challenge is we create a community. And so you feel connected to other people. So it's not just about you. It's about the community of people you're working out with. It's about the impact that it's had in your family life. So as you start to build momentum in this fitness area, I feel like it's kind of like that snowball, you know, pushing up. And at some point, it gains momentum. You get to the top of the hill, and it's going to go down.
Keeps growing.
There
keeps
it is.
Growing. I'm hoping that in the future, Tyrone, we are even more successful inviting the professional community in our Twin Cities here. I think that there are men and women like in our age group. I'm at the top end of your age group. Mm-hmm. But there are men and women who are professionals and who are visible. And who I know they think they want to figure out a way to both improve their personal lives, but be a model for others. So I'm hoping that this conversation, this television show, this radio show will encourage them to go ahead and take the step, not put it off, but to call today or step up today and decide that nutrition belongs to me, I belong to nutrition, that fitness belongs to me, I belong to a fitness strategy. And if they choose to support, choose to join and benefit from the Insight to Health Fitness Challenge. I was in a meeting earlier today and someone said, oh, give me Tyrone's number. I got to call him because I've been thinking about this. He's your, I said, yeah, I gave him, you get a call.
I did not get a call as of yet. So.
Okay, well, she'll be watching the show, so she should have called you, but
okay.
She will.
Yeah.
But that's what it's all about, is us connecting and having our people step up, engage, and get busy on this. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we can't measure the impact that when you have prominent people in the community, taking the bull by the horns and saying, I'm going to lead by example, mm-hmm. and not just because it almost seems like people think it's either or. Either I'm a champion for changing structures and working on programs, or I'm totally fitness. And I think you can find that happy medium where you can be at the forefront and improving the health of the community, but also making sure that you take care of yourself mm-hmm. first. Mm-hmm. I think that speaks volumes with for the leaders and their total commitment, not just to preaching changing health, but living it.
Demonstrating it. And that aligns with your concept of food first.
Yes.
Of thinking about food, knowing that food can be your ally or your adversary.
Yes.
But if you think about it the right way and are proactive, you can make powerful decisions for yourself, right, Julie?
Absolutely. In a real simple step-by-step process. Instead of trying to change everything at once, just take it step by step.
Walk us through some of the training that we get with you, Tyrone.
Yeah, you know, and so here again is the beauty of our fitness challenge is that you get a variety of trainers. I don't know if people would, even though they would enjoy it afterwards and the results, I don't know if they quite want to see my face 5 days a week, knowing how much I'm going to challenge him. You know, personally, I like to involve total body activities. We do everything from body weight strength training to using implements such as kettlebells, dumbbells, working the heart, improving flexibility. Again, the same way we've designed the Inside the Health Challenge, that's the way I design a workout or a program for an individual or groups. It's the holistic approach. You know, there's various components to being physically fit. It's not just about being strong, but it's also muscle endurance, making sure your joints are mobile, your muscles, flexibility. There is muscle strength, that is an aspect, but and ultimately the goal is to produce someone who is of a healthy weight, of a healthy body composition, because that's oftentimes overlooked. And again, to produce a person that can be functional and do everything that they want to do in their life, regardless of their age.
Up and down the stairs, lifting, the you know, mowing the lawn, all the activities that you do every day, you train to that.
Yeah. And even recreational activities, because as you age, you may have to modify some of the things, but you shouldn't have to give up the things that you enjoy. And so I just think the more we can implement these holistic fitness programs across the generations, that just equals, in my mind, a longer, healthier, higher quality of life.
Well, Tyrone, let me tell you what I love most about this, and part of this is going to hurt me more than it hurts me, but I'll say it anyway. I love burpees.
Yes.
I hate burpees. I really hate burpees, but I've learned to tell Tyrone I love burpees. What I also learned is to never brag in front of Tyrone, so I'm saying this, Tyrone, without being braggadocious, okay? So I'm humbly saying I love flipping the tire. We have a tractor tire that you and I had, and we flipped up and down the alley, and so it was hard work, hard doing it, but boy, did I feel good doing that. And I tell you, honestly, you know, I wanted to make sure somebody in the neighborhood saw me. You know, I said, if I got to do this, you know, I hope some people in the neighborhood see me doing this, right? I loved running up and down the bleachers at, where was it, University of Minnesota. You know, that's just awesome. I would never have done that, but you had me out there doing that. I remember the first time we ran around the lake, I almost died. I really did. I mean, I felt so bad, I thought I wasn't going to live, but I can get around that now, you know, and we've done the mile a couple of times anyway.
Absolutely.
And I survived it and improved my times. And so the point I want to make to our viewers and our listeners, this life change, this lifestyle change, this ability to do things even at this stage of life, and I'm saying this should be for everybody at whatever stage of life they're in, it is so worth it, so rewarding, so fulfilling, and so necessary. And as Black people whose experience with health, with the disparities, we got to pay more attention. And so I want to invite all of our viewers, all of our listeners who have this thought, who have the conversation, to be part of it, to be in it, and to put their minds and their bodies to work to do personal improvement, but do it in a way that reflects your sense of obligation to the entire community. Because that's how we reduce the disparities. We have everybody changing, every life improving, each one. What do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's kind of the old saying, each one teach one. You know, so if we can impact an individual, they in turn can be a voice and can impact maybe their children. Maybe they're a role model for their children. And actually, with you sharing your story, you're probably not doing it justice unless you go back and tell people where you were. Mm-hmm. I mean, when we started, mm-hmm. you couldn't jog.
No, not at all. 330 pounds. 330.
Yep. Yeah. Over 300 pounds. Couldn't jog. And, you know, a year later, you're running a sub 12 mile, mm-hmm. 12 minute mile. You're down 50, 60 pounds. Mm-hmm. And I'm an educator as well. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if this is a good thing or not, but I work with youth, mm-hmm. Ages 12 to 14, mm-hmm. and some of them, many of them, mm-hmm. can't run a sub 12 minute mile.
Okay.
All right. Well, mm-hmm. It's important to know that this can be done still. So, you know, I simply want to encourage people to hear this conversation, to join the conversation, to be part of this movement with us. One of the things we have in mind for next year, 2016, is to do something that's more family and to figure out how to get children involved, because we're having this wonderful success with adults, 30s, 40s. I've always been about the oldest one in the group. But we think that now we can modify the program based on your teaching skills and your working with children to involve the family and families with children as well. So we're working it out as we speak.
Yeah, and it's important, Mac, because this is the first generation who the predictions are that we are going to outlive them in terms of lifespan. And that absolutely, with technology and the knowledge that we have about nutrition and exercise, that's unacceptable. And so this cross-generational approach that we're taking to make it more of a family affair, I think that it's going to be hugely impactful on the families that we work with.
Okay. And as you know, we're both looking at figuring out how we can connect this on a national level through the National Newspaper Publishers Association Foundation. My goal as a communicator is to be able to create a story and tell the story. Tyrone Minor, owner of FitLab, Julie McMahon, owner of Nutrition Julie, the Food First System. I want to thank both of you for being on the program today. I thank you for being my friends and for working with me. I'm claiming the life-changing power that you represent and that you deliver. And I think I'm an example. I hope to be and continue to be a case study for you. I want to be a case study that you can use to say, if Al McFarlane can do it, anybody can do it.
Absolutely. Yes.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
I'm
Thank
Al
you,
McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. Join us again next time.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Because this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we got to get